finishing and Emotions, which is actually a project he executed whilst he was still working at Fox IT. Currently, he's working at Stedin, which is the Dutch network provider of electricity and energy. There she works at the Security Operations Center, watching OT, operational technology. So I hope next year she will come to and have a talk on that.
Who knows?
But today, you will talk about your research on
I hacked a township, and all you get is this lousy presentation. Just to be clear, a township is the place where you go to get a new ID or your driver's license. I think the right word is municipality or gemeente in Dutch, but Google Translate will be this one. So, who am I? I'm Daniela Dreis, and I work at Stedin currently, and I work in the OT sub. We call it a cyber defense center because that's a more fancy word for it. What did I study? I studied my safety and securities bachelor. That's an HBO study here in the Netherlands. And I did a really cool project that I'd like to share with you today. But how did I get here? At Hacker Hotel and also into the cybersecurity field. I decided to pursue a career in cybersecurity back in 2017. I did my studies and it was the third year and I had to do an internship. And I didn't know what I wanted to do. All my classmates were going to the police or the township, army even, and my studies had nothing to do with cybersecurity because back then it wasn't that much of a thing as it is now. So, but then I think WannaCry or NotPetya happened, one or the other, and it got more media coverage and I figured, hey, that's a very interesting field. And I think I would like to work there. But of course, I mean, I didn't have a technical background, so how do you get there? So I did my own research, I started teaching myself some stuff, and I figured, okay, where do I want to do my internship? Probably a good cybersecurity company, and I figured Fox IT would be the best opportunity, but I figured, you know, IT, they probably don't want to hire non-technical people, but I messaged them anyway. So I told them, hey, I've been, you know, working on getting my knowledge up, getting, you know, into the world of networking and stuff, and they actually wanted me to do their internship. They also offered me a position at their SOC. I didn't know what it was back then, but I was like, sure, I'm gonna do it, we'll see what happens, and I only ended up working there for 10 months. After a year, it was time to graduate for me, and I was thinking, okay, what do I want to do for my graduation? I want to do something cool, something that school would also like, and something that's not too technical, but still, you know, get a little bit of the hacking thing going on. So that's when I met some cool people from the audit department at Fox. One of them is here, Eva. And I met Sonne Maasakkers. I think some of you know her. I actually got befriended with her. She told me you can do a phishing assignment with us if you want. I'm sorry, interested in phishing. Because phishing, I think it's a very interesting thing. I think we've all received phishing emails daily. Does anyone here dare to admit that they have fallen for phishing? No? We have fallen for it or we don't want to admit it. I think in the past I probably have clicked on a phishing link. And I have to say, some of them are getting very good, others are so bad that I'm surprised people fall for it, but it seems the paradox is the worse your phishing emails, the more people fall for it. So I was interested in phishing because I like the art of deception thing that's going on with phishing. Because phishing works because you deceive someone. You tell someone that they will get X if they do Y. Phishing works because often certain emotions are triggered with people. And what happens when your emotion is triggered that you temporarily your judgment gets blurred. If I succeedingly send you a phishing note and I can scare you with something and you believe it, then suddenly you're not very rational anymore. You start to panic, like, oh no, I have to pay this, or oh no, someone has photos of me, whatever. People get scared or whatever, and then they do things that they maybe normally wouldn't do. So that's how you can convince someone to maybe give you bitcoins, give you personal information, or to log on to your random page. So this psychological aspect really interested me, and I figured I can do something with this, especially with the help of the audit department. So I started researching, okay, how does phishing work, and is there more information on the emotions, the art of deception? So eventually I narrowed it down to these four emotions: fear, greed, authority, and helplessness. I think that these four emotions are very interesting. I think we all encounter that sometimes. Okay, authority is not really an emotion, but you feel like someone has authority over you, you have to do something with that. So the challenge here was, set up a large phishing attack containing four emails with these different emotions and test them out on people to see which one works best. And then let the best fish win. But I didn't want to stop there. I figured, okay, I mean, four emotions, that's interesting, four emails, you know, which will win. I wanted to do something else. I also wanted to make a distinction between the two types of phishing. Well, there's more types than this, but there's credential harvesting, for example, where you send someone a login page that's not real and you hope that they will log into it. Or you send someone a download that's actually malware, so malware executable. I figured those two would be very interesting to try out. So my setup was this. Sorry, it's in Dutch, but I will translate it. I have four main emails. All emotions have different types of emails. So they're not the same, but they all contain the emotion. And every email has two options. So you either get fear malware or you get fear credential. So in total, I had 8 emails. But who did I fish? Well, my victim was a township, gemeente here in the Netherlands. They have over 4,000 employees, which I thought was great because that means there's a great variety in age, computer skills, awareness, I mean, you have all different kinds of people. They also have like 50 departments, so that means they're not all in one office. Some people are working from home, some people work in the field, or it's all different types of people. So I figured that would be good because then if someone receives email A, then they will immediately alert everyone around them. So they were willing to let me fish them. Fox IT and the audit department do this sometimes, you know, they get phishing assignments, so they fish companies, so they had experience with it. So I did some research on the heuristics of phishing. I looked up, okay, what do successful phishing attacks contain? So there's a few of the heuristics that I added in every email, like you can see the logo, copy the style, the domain names didn't have the SSL in the URL, type was coding, and try to match the email address to the organization. Here you can see the domain names that I used. So as you can see, I tried to make them very realistic. And let's go to the fun part, the emails. So the first one that I did was the authority one. Prefos Audit is a company that doesn't really exist. So I just used a logo maker online, and I used a program that you can use to make emails. It has certain templates, and you can use them and just create whatever email you like, or a newsletter, or whatever. So this one I did, I asked the people, the employees, to fill in a survey for an audit, and it was an audit on GDPR. And we all know GDPR sucks, but I also made them fill it in before March 1st at 3 o'clock, and that was 2 days after they got the email. Fear, I did an unknown login attempt, and I used the location of a place in Delft. It's near Fox City, actually, so I thought it would be funny to implement that in the email. Helpfulness, I did internet. There was going to be a new internet, and in the company, there were a lot of people a little bit angry about it. They were like, I don't know about the internet. So the company actually told me, the township, they told me that a lot of people were very opinionated about the internet. So I figured, okay, if I use this one, people will probably want to click on this and fill in the survey. Greed was the last one, and I think this is the best one actually, because it was for a new iPhone. So I told the people, you are part of a pilot group that's going to receive an iPhone. And I asked them to click on the link if they wanted to place the order. And here you can see the clone login page. So this is, by the way, I added the Fox logo. This is not the logo, obviously, but I wanted to add something in. And this is the login page that they used. So what I did here is I changed the URL of the login page. So people should have been able to notice that this was not the real login page. I also made a meet. So D-Day arrived. Okay. On this day, we were going to send all the emails to the company, the township, and we actually went over there, me and Sanne. And what we did was we decided not to send all the emails at once, because if you send them all at once, it might become too suspicious to people. So at 11:51, we sent the first two emails. So the first emotion, we sent two emails to the first 1,000 people. After 20 minutes, we had the first 8 malware infections, 29 unique logins, and 45 service desk reports. We did include the service desk in our operation, because we figured, okay, they're probably going to receive some emails, some calls. Well, they did not prepare for the shit show that came their way. At 13:15, we sent the second batch of emotion emails. I'm not going to tell you which ones, because I wanted to be surprised which one wins. We sent it to the next 1,000 people. At 13:26, we already had 196 service desk reports. People were getting suspicious by now, because they were like, is this spam, is it phishing, what do I do with this? At lead time, we sent the third emotion to the next batch. And at round 2, we had the last emotion sent out. But then, 14:30, people were getting suspicious. Because on the internet, someone posted the Prevost audit email. And was asking, hey, did anyone else receive this, is this phishing? People started commenting like, hey, I also received something. I also received something about a login attempt. And someone actually took the effort to search the location of the fake login attempt. Like there was a location on Google Maps. Someone looked it up and actually posted this photo. And what I did was I used the location of the called the Beast Market. It's a place where there's many terraces. And someone actually posted it, like, hey, it looks sunny. So that's when people started to realize, okay, maybe this isn't real. Some people said, okay, it might be a good idea to communicate this to the people. And then someone exposed us. Someone said, it's from Fox IT. So I asked the security department, like, hey, who is this person? It was a system admin, and what they did was that they probably did a whois lookup on the domain names, and they were still on Fox IT. So they figured out, like, okay, this is probably phishing. But that's okay, because we were still getting actually logins and malware executions. And we also figured out that in the Excel sheet that we used, there were apparently some duplicates, and 16 people received their email 60 times.
Oh.
So, sorry, people. So their inbox was overflowing. And around 5 we were done, so all the emails were sent, 4,000 people almost got an email, but then we realized that obviously some people were like working from home, so maybe not everyone had read their email by then. I mean, we started at 12 and we stopped at around 5, so we waited until the day after to make the final count at 2. So in total, we got 299 unique credentials, 219 infections, which makes a grand total of 518 from around 4,000 people. So that's a lot. Was good for us, not so good for the township. But also, this one I thought was very funny, 643 service desk reports, which is a lot. So not only did we basically hack the township, we also DDoSed the service desk. Good thing we prepared them for it. So the total numbers are these ones. Let's start with FEAR. I made a distinction between the total logins and the unique logins. As you can see, there is a difference in the numbers, so that means some people have logged in twice. Also, same thing with execution, so there's a distinction between downloading and executing. Helpfulness is this one. Also a nice number, a little bit more downloads than logins. Authority, when a high number of logins, also pretty high number of executions. but the best for last, greed. People are very greedy. They really wanted a new iPhone. And they had 100 unique logins, which is a lot, and 85 executions. And here's also a very high number of total and unique difference. So that means a lot of people downloaded the malware executable, nothing happened, they downloaded it again, they downloaded it again, or logged in and they were like, okay, where is my iPhone? And yeah, so that was quite a fun project. Obviously the winner's greed. Dutch people, they like free things. So yeah, the winner is greed, which I kind of anticipated. I actually did a survey at the poll at the audit department because I figured, okay, they have experience with these things. And only Eva guessed it right, so you go. yeah, so actually everyone thought that fear would be winning. So for the logins, greed was the winner, obviously. Authority, second, helpfulness was last. But then for downloads, fear was actually last, which I kind of figured because if you receive an email that says there has been like an unidentified login attempt, and then you get to download something, then I obviously wouldn't execute it. It also said like blah blah dot exe. By the way, the malware didn't do anything to their computers, it just registered a plus one. We swear. Click rate was pretty high, 23%. So 71% of the people who received the mail didn't click, so it's like the total of all the emails. The 23% did click, and I think that's a pretty high number. The login rate was also pretty high, so from the people who did click, 66% actually logged in and gave us their credentials. Also, work needs to be done there. 19% downloaded the malware executable, and then 58% also executed it. So that's also a pretty high number. So that was my presentation. Does anyone have any questions?
Thank you very much, Daniel. Thank you. I can imagine there's some questions or suggestions, theories here and there. Did you? Yeah.
At our company, we use GoFish as a framework. What do you use?
Okay. The question for the internet: GoFish. Do you use?
Like as to prevent it or?
No, GoFish is a framework. You send out emails and evaluate the results.
Oh, like that? No.
Don't use GoFish.
No.
Other questions? Yeah. So
what? What action did the community do after they received these figures?
Oh no, that's funny because you know, people were questioning like what's happening, was this phishing? Because I told the service desk to tell everyone like, oh, thank you for your report, we're working on it, whatever. And then I actually made like a nice form afterwards with all the numbers, same numbers that I told here, and I actually sent it out and then they put it on the internet. And then some people liked it and they were like, oh yeah, then well, that's cool. Some people were like, is this where our tax money is going? So some people were really angry, and I think a lot of people are angry about the iPhone. They didn't receive the iPhone and they got like...
But they still wanted to receive the iPhone.
Yeah, so like, that's why I think because the number of service desk reports actually went up after the iPhone, because people were asking, oh hey, what type of iPhone is it? can I get a second one? People were sending them to private emails to other colleagues. So there was a lot to do with the iPhone.
Are horrible.
Yes, that's why I said greedy bastards.
One final question or remark in the back there, I don't.
What would you recommend?
What would you recommend?
Well, I mean, in this case, I have to say, they did look legitimate. I mean, I did use very specific domain names. I used a pretty professional program to make the emails. So they looked good. It's not like the crappy PayPal phishing with all like spelling mistakes. It was pretty good, but what I would recommend is training. Again, they need some training again. I guess use these things as an example to give everyone a good training. I think they also put some tips in the internet message, like, okay, please always check the link. always check the if there's HTTPS, or always check the domain names.
So you can say that, that your research itself was a huge awareness campaign, wasn't it?
Yes, definitely.
Yeah.
So I guess I don't know what it is now, but they had some work to do.
Maybe Harry do it.
That would be interesting. I don't know if they will let me in again.